The Albanese government has announced the launch of the Australian Submarine Agency this morning. Vice Admiral Jonathan Mead will lead 680 staff over the next year to oversee Australia's nuclear-powered submarine program based out of Canberra. Joining me more on this is Malcolm Davis, Senior Analyst at the Australian Strategic Policy Institute. Malcolm, good to see you. This has been heralded by Deputy Prime Minister Richard Marles as a significant day and the single biggest investment in our defence capability in history.
Look, I think the submarine project certainly is in terms of the sheer scale and scope and cost of these eight submarines. And it makes sense to have a dedicated agency to essentially manage this project, because this is a project that's going to last decades. And it's not just about buying the boats. It's about all the support infrastructure and the technology and the skills and the training and the work base that goes with it. So, this is a good step by the Albanese government.
We know Indonesia's President Joko Widodo has expressed concerns about Australia's ambition to build nuclear-powered submarines, fearing it could lead to further military mobilisation in the Indo-Pacific. Joko Widodo is arriving in Sydney on Monday for his first visit to Australia in over 3 years. Is AUKUS and now the Australian Submarine Agency causing tensions with Indonesia?
They're not, in the sense that this is a line that is being pushed out of Beijing, that somehow Australia getting nuclear-powered but not nuclear-armed submarines is somehow causing tension and generating an arms race. But in actual fact, if you look at what China is doing, they're rapidly building up the number of nuclear-powered submarines they have, and those submarines do have nuclear weapons. So it's interesting that China is pushing this line. Some Southeast Asian states are essentially parroting it. And it is a case for Australia to sit down with the Indonesians and other ASEAN states and make them understand that these submarines are not nuclear armed. It's not about proliferation. They will be managed under very tight International Atomic Energy Agency controls and regulations. So there'll be no diversion of fissile material, and essentially counteract the propaganda that's being put out from Beijing.
All right. To the latest situation in Ukraine, a Ukrainian military spokesperson says its forces have made progress around the eastern city of Bakhmut, but the US has acknowledged the early stages of Kyiv's counteroffensive has fallen short of expectations and are strongly considering approving the transfer of controversial cluster munitions to Ukraine, as reported by CNN. What's your take on this?
Well, yeah, the counteroffensive has gone slower, and I think we should have expected that. I think that we looked at what the Ukrainians were able to do last year around Kharkiv and Kherson, and they did these lightning-fast counteroffensives, which were extremely successful. This time around, the Ukrainians are going up against very well-prepared Russian defences. The Russians have had months to get these in place. So there's three defensive lines there that the Ukrainians have to breach. Lots of forces, so it is going a lot slower. The Ukrainians are making less progress than we'd hoped, but we should not have got our hopes up too much with this. We just have to stick with the Ukrainians. We have to make sure that they get the weapon systems they need. The cluster munitions issue is a controversial one, but the Russians are using that and worse against the Ukrainians. So I think it's appropriate to level the field. And I'm sure that the Ukrainians will take every opportunity and caution to make sure that those cluster munitions are not directed in any way against civilian targets, unlike the Russians.
Ukraine's intelligence agency also believes the FSB, the Russian Federal Security Services, has been told to assassinate Wagner boss Yevgeny Prigozhin, but no one knows where he is.
Yeah, and it's a mystery. Supposedly he fled to Belarus after the deal was signed, but then his jet turned up in Moscow and then went over to St Petersburg. So it is a bit of a mystery where Prigozhin is and just what his status is, where the Wagner forces are in terms of their spread between Russia, Ukraine and Belarus, and just what the future holds. And I think it's really uncertain as to how this shapes up. But I think the one certainty out of all of this is that Putin is a much diminished figure. He's much more vulnerable to coups, not just from Wagner, but from various different other private military corporations and warlords and faction leaders inside Russia. So I think that the Wagner insurrection the other weekend was the opening act, but the main phase of this drama is yet to get going.
So after the almost coup with Wagner, is Putin beginning to win the PR war within Russia again? Are Russians rallying around him? Because that's some of the news reports we have seen. Or, as you say, is it becoming terminal for Putin?
Look, I think it's very easier for an authoritarian state to manipulate news reports and present the image that they want to present, and that's called propaganda. I frankly think that for Putin, it is becoming much more difficult to see how he's going to hang on to power in the long term. I think that probably the wolves are circling. He understands that, which is why he started a purge within the Russian military leadership. But it's the Siloviki and the oligarchs, the security and intelligence elite and the elite business people that I think will be looking to see if he becomes too weak, do they put forward another and they get rid of Putin.
Malcolm Davis, a pleasure to chat with you as always. Thank you.
Thank you.